Let me make it clear. So, I think everyone has no problem with this part. So this part,
oh no. Let me try to copy this. No, I can somehow I can copy. So, but, okay, let's write down again. So I guess everyone is okay with this expression. Ra is L cosine theta 1 I minus L sine, was it cosine theta? Sine cosine. Sine cosine sine cosine so I think everyone's okay with this expression, but take a derivative is the first you have to check the which one is time varying, which one is function of time, because we are going to take a derivative of it. Function of time, this one changes with time, this one changes with time, this one is also changing with time because angle theta 2 is keep changing. This one is also changing with time. This unit vector is also changing with time. This is also changing with time. So derivative of RA, first term is simple. You just take derivative of each term because there's nothing more term appears. It was just one term. But I use chain rule here. So you got L cosine theta 1 dot I minus L cosine theta 1 derivative is sine theta minus sine theta 1, that's why it becomes plus and theta 1 dot J. Second line, this term should have two terms, derivative of this sine theta 2 and derivative of IB. Because it's a multiplication of two time-varying terms. Okay. Remember this d by dt. If two functions is f and g function of time, this is f dot g plus f g dot. It's the same thing, even if it's a vector. Okay. So first part will be L. First I take the sine theta 2, that becomes cosine theta 2. Multiply by theta 2 dot IB and take the derivative of IB. I got plus L sine theta 2 derivative of IB. I said that this is becomes omega cross IB, therefore I write down this is omega cross IB. Okay, this is the derivative of this first term, and then second term in the second line, same thing, minus L cosine theta 2 becomes sine minus sine theta 2, therefore this becomes plus theta 2 dot JB, and then they take a derivative of JB dot. This becomes plus, because of the cross product relation, minus going inside, so it becomes L, oh no, actually minus sine should be there. Minus cosine theta 2 omega cross JB. Okay? This is it. Yeah? Okay, then I write down, I use the expression, notational convention. This is derivative of RB, so RB dot. this is the derivative of, not exactly derivative of RC, but the derivative of RC only the scalar term. But still, we are using the same notation, RC dot. Okay, then what about the last term? Can I write down last term more simpler way? Yes, you can. Look at this. I'm going to moving this guy here. Only I consider this last term. Then I can take out omega cross in front because omega cross is a common term for both. Cross product satisfies the distribution law. Okay, so I can take out omega cross in front. And then everything inside, same, L sine theta 2 IB minus L cosine theta 2 JB. Okay? Did you notice anything for this guy? That guy is RC. This is RC. So in fact, if I write down everything, RA dot is RB dot plus RC dot plus omega cross RC. Yes? Oh, actually, this because this I have a minus sign here to express this one, so I need two minus sign to make it plus. It becomes plus because this minus sign is hidden inside of omega cross JB. So, in fact, this omega cross JB inside there's a minus sign. So if you take out that minus sign outside, this becomes plus. Yes, it is. If you expand this part, this becomes plus. But I put the two minus sign so that I can use this omega cross JB expression. So this is the usually expression you can see in the textbook. But it implies that this RA is expressed in the two different coordinates, inertial and body coordinates. This RB is expressed in the inertial coordinates. RC expressed in the body coordinates. This, of course, expressed in the body coordinates. This everything is expressed in body coordinates. So, when you are saying that the derivative of something means that if the inertial coordinate, you can do derivative, right? You can take a derivative as before, as usual. But if it's expressed in the rotating coordinate, you take the derivative of that term as usual and plus omega cross this term. That's it. So what I'm saying is that if some vector, it could be anything, any vector. It could be a position vector, velocity vector, or acceleration vector, any vector. If we expressed in the body coordinates, rotating coordinates, if you want to take a derivative of this by time, expression is simple. Just you take the derivative of this guy, as usual, this dot means as usual, take derivative of scalar term. And then you just adding one more term, which is omega, which is the rotating angular velocity of that moving frame, cross product itself, original vector, expressed in the body frame. That's it. So this is the expression you should memorize. For anything, rotating. This is the only equation. This one has a special name, actually. This one has a, this one is called, this one is called somehow transport theorem. Because if you remember this, you don't even need to memorize the IB dot is the theta dot times JB, or JB dot is minus theta dot times IB. You don't even memorize that. Only thing is that you need to memorize this. Then you can easily drive this IB dot and JB dot. Can I do that? Let's do that. So d by dt, IB. Obviously, IB is expressed in the body rotating frame. What's the scalar part derivative of this? What's the scalar part of this vector? One, number one. So one is here. So d by dt, one, multiplied by IB. That's the first part. This is derivative of the scalar part. This is obviously zero, because take derivative of constant is zero. The remaining part is omega cross IB. What was the omega? We assume that positive rotation in z-axis, then which means that omega times KB cross IB. K cross I is J. So this is omega JB. Same thing, d by dt, jb. Constant part is again zero, scalar part. Then remaining is omega cross jb. Omega was omega times kb. K cross jb is minus ib. Therefore, you got minus omega ib. So easy, right? So just something is expressed in the rotating, you just take the usual derivative plus omega rotating angular velocity cross product of that quantity. That's it. That's the only thing you should memorize. If you memorize this transport theorem, then you can derive all this looks complicated expression quite easily. Therefore, using this expression, if you have a measurement in the first and second joint angle and angular velocity, then you can calculate the tip of the second pendulum. Try to practice by yourself. Then you can be more familiar with this expression. Any questions so far? Okay. Now, because we have a velocity, next thing is obviously we want to have the acceleration. But acceleration is just a mechanistic derivation of this. So, I use this simple expression, maybe I would call it confused expression, which you can see in the book. So RB, RA, we know now velocity. So this is the compact expression. But if I take the derivative, it's simple. So RA double dot, I just repeatedly using this transport theorem. RA double dot is RB double dot. RB, remember, was expressed in the inertial plane. So it's just a normal derivative. So RB just becomes RB double dot. RC dot, this velocity is expressed in the rotating plane. Therefore, you need the normal derivative plus omega cross itself. So this guy becomes normal derivative is just RC double dot plus omega cross itself, which was RC dot. So this two term is derivative of RC dot. Okay? This is, I just use consistently the transportive theorem. And then this one is the multiplication of two terms. Therefore, first you have to derivative of omega plus derivative of RC. But both are expressed in the moving frame. So you should take the normal derivative plus omega derivative, omega cross product. So let's take a derivative of first omega. Then omega is expressed in the rotating frame, normal derivative omega dot plus additional term, which is omega cross itself, which was omega cross omega, RC. Oops, this is cross. Sorry. So this is the derivative of the first this guy. This one going to here. And this is a multiplication. Therefore, I have to take derivative of second RC as well. So this is omega cross. RC is also expressed in the rotating frame. Therefore, it is the normal derivative plus omega cross itself. Let me expand it. So RB double dot plus RC double dot plus omega cross RC dot plus omega dot plus cross RC. What about omega cross omega? Huh? What's the result of the cross product of the same vector? Zero. It's the same cross product is zero. Same if the perpendicular two vector dot product, that's zero. But the cross product is the same parallel vector. If they cross product it, then it's zero. So this part is zero. So I don't care about. Then here's last term I can expand. That's omega cross RC dot. And finally, this is omega cross RC. Would it be this one is zero? No. No. Because the cross product doesn't satisfy this associate law. So you cannot do the cross product this first. You cannot do that. You have to cross product this. So this is not necessarily zero. So this is different from zero. So I can see that these two terms are same term. Omega cross RC dot. Therefore this becomes RB double dot plus RC double dot plus two times omega cross RC dot and omega dot cross RC plus omega cross RC. This is the RA dot. So originally in the derivation looks quite complicated, but at the end, the only thing you need is this transport theorem. Once you remember the transport theorem, the calculating the velocity and the acceleration is just mechanistic applying the theorem. Let's look at each term by term what that means. This is the acceleration by the first pendulum acceleration, because we attached our rotating moving coordinates at the tip of the first pendulum. So this is caused by the first pendulum acceleration. This RC is the relative acceleration to the moving coordinate. So this is the second pendulum acceleration, but relative to the moving the body frame. And this acceleration, omega dot, is caused by angular acceleration, omega dot, which is angular acceleration, omega dot. This is caused by omega dot. The angle, if your angle rotating velocity changes, then this acceleration is generated. What about this one? This one you may be quite familiar with. This is centrifugal acceleration. The most interesting part is this guy, 2 times omega cross RC dot. This is Coriolis acceleration. Coriolis acceleration. I'm not sure this spelling is correct. I always write it wrong way. But this is Coriolis acceleration. Any questions so far? So I'm going to show you some video about Coriolis acceleration.
Rotating is in the observation of the sun during the day.
Let me make it bigger.
So it is clear that the Earth is rotating. However, as an observer on the surface of the Earth, the only indication our planet is rotating is in the observation of the sun during the day and the stars during the night. Every day the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, but we are completely unaware that we are traveling to the east at hundreds of miles per hour. So just how fast are we moving? Well, at the equator, the rotational velocity of the Earth is an incredibly fast 1,018 miles an hour. If you were to travel from the equator to about 30 degrees north latitude, the rotational velocity would have slowed considerably to about 882 miles an hour. Well, why? Well, as you walk north or south from the equator, you're actually getting closer and closer to the Earth's axis of rotation. Because the surface of the Earth is solid, the rotational velocity will decrease as you walk north or south from the equator, because you're actually getting closer and closer to the Earth's axis of rotation. To understand this better, let's imagine that we take the Earth, a sphere, and flatten it out into a rotating disk, like a merry-go-round. If you were to stand on the edge of the merry-go-round, the rotational velocity would be large, and you would feel like you're going to fly off. However, if you stand in the middle, the rotational velocity would be much less, and you would feel like you're barely spinning at all. Now, what if we were to have two people sit on opposite sides of the merry-go-round and try to throw a ball to one another? You can see that as the ball leaves the hands of the person throwing it, it becomes independent of the rotation of the merry-go-round, and therefore follows a straight path. But because the person trying to catch the ball is still rotating with the merry-go-round, they are quickly moved out of the ball's intended path. Because the merry-go-round is spinning counterclockwise, this deflection is to the right. If it were spinning clockwise, the deflection would be to the left. Now, to an observer above the merry-go-round, the path of the ball appears straight. However, to people on the merry-go-round, the path of the ball curves to the right of the intended motion. This experiment demonstrates how the rotation of the merry-go-round appears to cause a deflection in the path of the ball. This also demonstrates how air movement on the Earth's surface can be deflected by the Earth's rotation, a phenomenon called the Coriolis effect. How do we relate the effects of the Coriolis force to air motion in our atmosphere? To answer this question, let's first investigate what would happen to a parcel of air that was initially at rest with respect to the Earth. At 30 degrees north latitude, the parcel is traveling to the east with the Earth. But if we were to shove this parcel at 10 miles an hour to the north, what would happen to its motion? We have already seen from the merry-go-round experiment that the ball would be deflected to the right. But why? The answer lies in understanding something called the conservation of angular momentum. Angular momentum is the product of the mass times the velocity times the radius of a rotating object. The conservation of angular momentum tells us that for a rotating object, the product of its mass, velocity, and radius is constant for that system. Well, what does this mean? Think of a ball swinging around on a string. If you shorten the length of the string, the rotating ball spins faster. Angular momentum, however, is conserved because as you decrease the radius or the length of the string, the velocity or the rotational speed of the ball is increased so that the product of the velocity times the radius times the mass stay the same. As an example, let's consider a ball that weighs 1 kilogram on a string that is 1.5 meters long, spinning at 5 meters per second. When we calculate the angular momentum, we find its value is 7.5. If we shorten the string, we know that the ball will spin faster. So if the radius of rotation is reduced to 1/2 meter, the rotational velocity must increase to 15 meters per second so that the product of the mass times the velocity and radius remains at 7.5. Now, how does all of this apply to this parcel that we shoved north? Well, as we moved it to the north, the rotational speed of the Earth will decrease. However, because the parcel of air is actually moving closer and closer to the axis of rotation, its rotational velocity must increase by the conservation of angular momentum. If you were standing at 30 degrees north and watching the parcel as it moved, it would appear to be deflected to the right. This apparent deflection is the direct result of the Coriolis force. What is really interesting is that if the parcel continues to be deflected, it would trace out a path along the Earth's surface that kept its original speed of 10 miles an hour constant with respect to the rotation of the Earth. Therefore, the path of the parcel would eventually trace out a circle, much like the path of this baseball on the merry-go-round. Watch as Amanda pushes the ball out to the center and it makes a complete circle back to her other side. Some important facts about Coriolis force. First, the Coriolis force causes objects to deflect to the right of their intended path in the northern hemisphere and to the left in the southern hemisphere. This is why low pressure systems like hurricanes and extratropical cyclones circulate counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere. Second, the Coriolis force affects the direction of an object, not its speed. Third, the strength of the deflection is proportional to the speed. For example, the faster an airplane flies, the more the pilot must adjust the flight track to account for the Coriolis force. And finally, the Coriolis force is zero at the equator and maximum at the poles. To leave you with an interesting fact, the effects of the rotation of the Earth are negligible at very small scales. For example, if a pitcher were to throw a pitch at Wrigley Field to home plate at 100 miles an hour, the deflection of the path of the ball is very small, only about 900 microns, which is about 0.9 millimeters, or about the thickness of your fingernail. However, for an intercontinental ballistic missile, if shot a few thousand miles at 1,000 miles per hour, the deflection is hundreds of miles.
So this is the Coriolis acceleration, but they said that the Coriolis force. And I think you also, some student says that sometimes this is centrifugal force. But this is really acceleration. But acceleration caused by this acceleration in some certain situation may be interpreted as a force. It's kind of pseudo force, but you feel like a force. But thing is this. Let's say this air particle is in the air, in the earth. This is air particle. Then this, if your air mass is so small, so you can ignore the gravitational force, then what happens is the Newton's second law says that sum of force is m times acceleration, which is in this case r a double dot. And if you ignore all the other forces, external forces, say that part is zero, then this, if I ignore the other side, then only remaining thing is m times rc double dot, oops, plus r a, I should write a first, and c double dot, plus 2 omega cos rc dot. Earth rotates with a constant angular velocity, therefore omega dot is zero. And this omega cross rc is relatively small. So I can ignore that. Then what you can see here is that m times, because Earth, we are on the Earth at the same time. We rotate with Earth with the same angular velocity. Therefore, we cannot see omega relative to Earth. Between Earth and the air, who are us, there's no angular velocity because we are rotating together. Therefore, in this equation, this Coriolis force moves the other side, minus m times, 2 times m times omega cross rc dot. So this behaves like a force. Okay? That's why air particle in the northern hemisphere always bending to the right. So if there's some low pressure developed, here's the center of the low pressure, then all the air is rushing into this low pressure. But because of this Coriolis force, this is Coriolis force, it's always bending slightly to the right. And then if you start bending to this here, then again it drags into this low pressure force to there, then again you're bending slightly from that. And again, you have to go that way, but you have to slightly bending to there. So your path looks like this way. Everywhere looks like this way. So that's why in the northern hemisphere, the hurricane rotates on the counterclockwise. On the other hand, the southern hemisphere, it rotates in the clockwise. There was an urban myth that the toilet rotor is rotating in the counterclockwise or clockwise, depending on the northern and southern hemisphere. That's not true. Because this Coriolis force is extremely small. The amount is very, very small. It cannot affect to the toilet water rotating direction. The hurricane affected because this air particle travels from here to there very long path. That's why this small force accumulated during this whole travel path. That's why you can see the significant difference. So, but toilet rotating? No, it's not. So usually saying that you observe the toilet water flushing is always in one direction in a certain region. That's most likely because that one company dominates that region to install this old toilet facility, so it's all same shape. That's why it's rotating in the consistent direction. Okay, that's that.
I'm going to give you just one small example and then wrap it up. Oh, not actually. Not it's not an example. This is the first problem at the fourth tutorial set. In the first problem at the tutorial set number 4, I asked the calculator velocity of the rotating wheel. So I think I can use this. Okay. So this is the wheel. So the radius, maybe you can call radius of this wheel is L. And this is rotating in this way.